The sky cascading, the colors are infinite.
And welcome to this, the fifth session in the Old Georgian Virtual Talks, in celebrating St. George's Day, 137 years. So thank you for joining us on this occasion. Today we've got Shaun February, class of 2009, joining us. But before we get into that, I'd like to share you a bit of interesting fact. The school song first appeared in 1927. Comprising of eight verses and a chorus in between. So that must have taken a while to sing in the morning. The original school song spoke of the beauty of Cape Town and the nature around, as well as the cathedral. And over time, some of the verses were changed or removed as times changed, settling on the song we have today, we sing today, which has three verses. And the last verse is traditionally sung by the leaving matrix in their final year. If you'd like to find out more information about the school song or any other information about St. George's from the past, please visit the Old Georgian Union website, and you can find lots of interesting information about your school there. But welcome, Shaun. Thank you for joining us on this public holiday, Freedom Day. Celebrating 27 years since our first non-racial elections. Shaun has been involved in many aspects of the school while at his time at St. George's. He was very involved in many sports. He was on committees. He was part of Round Square, President's Award, achieving his Gold Award, and serving on the Cape Town Youth Committee. And currently, Shaun is working with Stellenbosch University as a rugby coordinator for Marties Rugby, and has been involved in many of the rugby activities around Cape Town. So welcome, Shaun. Over to you.
Thanks, Stephen. I was at the grammar school, and it, for me, was an amazing experience. I became late in life as a student in my career. Instills certain values in you, but it was really the opportunities they provided, whether it was to serve on committees, which really prepped me for my working career going forward, or whether it was working with my fellow classmates in different environments, such as school sports or debating, or whatever the case is. And I think one of the biggest things that St. George's provides is the type of learners that come out of it. If I look at the students that I was at school with and what they're doing now, I mean, it's really leaders, it's go-getters, it's people that are individual in the sense where they have their identity and they know who they are, and they sort of not too scared to put themselves forward in positions of leadership or to take charge of situations. I mean, if I look at Songi Langeni, that was, I think, in 2005 with Tick, he went into film and now he's with Cricket South Africa. Andile is now also a director, and I mean, the list goes on. If you go a bit further back, you have Jeremy Addis now as a radio personality, and Jody Abrams that's on a lot of South African genres. So for me, the type of learners that the school produces, even though it might not necessarily be the number one academic student in Cape Town or the top sports star, it's really people that are leading leading individuals in their field. And it's one of the things that's always impressed me. And I think something we take for granted. You often don't realize what you learned at school or what the school sort of meant for you until you leave. And you look back at it and you think, yes, I actually did have a good time. And they did actually provide me with a great platform for future endeavors. And so I've always enjoyed my time at St. George's, and I've always tried to get that message across to current learners at the school. I think it was a couple of years ago, we had a St. George's Day talk, and we spoke about legacy. And the legacy that you leave really depends on you. I enjoyed my time at school because I made the most of it. I don't think I was the best student, and I think a few teachers will agree with me. But I like to think that I made the most of my opportunities, whether it was being involved with Dance Square Presence Award or getting involved with athletics days and, you know, those kind of things. So it's St. George's has played a massive part in my life. I was also very grateful to Mr. Hart at the time, who assisted me so that I could stay at the school, because my parents couldn't necessarily afford it. And they really loved the school so much. And there was a lot of support from the teacher side and from management at St. George's. And yeah, that's something I've always be grateful for. So you have a question, yes, Steve?
It always strikes me whenever we chat or chat to students, ex-students, the alumni, that they talk about their times very fondly at St. George's. And you're very right that there are many leaders in different industries out there who have come from St. George's. And it's great that you're able to share some of those names with us there. You mentioned this while you were at St. George's, you don't recall singing the school song. There was a time when the school song wasn't sung much. So I'm sure it sounds like it was during your time, but no, it's sung now. And at valedictory, the matric sing the last verse quite loudly and proudly. Even though these times now we have masks on, they still try and sing out loud.
Yeah. And I must say, Stephen, that I was fortunate in that I saw the school go through different phases. I got there, I was in grade one in 1998. When the school turned 150, and we still wore the grey shorts and the tie and the shirt, and then we moved over to the, you know, the now sort of cock uniform, and then when I left, the number ones came back. But also in that time, the school went through a lot of sort of development and transformation in a sense. You know, we did lose a few traditions, I'd say. And I've always been a bit of a traditionalist, so I've always been a bit of a sore point for me. But we've also created new traditions. And I think it's that comes from the staff and the new type of kids that come through there. And change is not always a bad thing. People are often scared to change. But I do think that the school has moved in the right direction. And it's just, for me, it does give me a lot of hope for the sort of future generations coming through.
Can I ask, you were involved with the President's Award and you achieved your Gold Award. What did you, how did that benefit you? What did, in your when leaving school, did that add value to you, to your endeavors after leaving school and going off to study and work? And if so, how?
Well, the funny thing is that I actually got quite involved with the President's Award afterwards, as a Gold Award holder, sort of joined the alumni network. So with the Cape Town Youth Committee, which was set up in my matric year, and I was fortunate enough to be chairperson of the award, that carried on for a good number of years afterwards, and I was always there, sort of a mentor. And in 2011, I was selected to attend the International Gold Event, which is held every 3 or 4 years. And that's where you have Gold Award holders from around the world coming together, and you have plannings and you have networking. So that helped a hell of a lot in terms of networking. I've got a friend in Zambia now that heads up the award program, and I asked him the similar question. You know, how the youth coming through that have done the award, how does it benefit them? And he's noted that a lot of businesses actually know about it, and it always looks good on your CV. It's also recognized internationally, especially in Europe, where the award is, has quite a big presence. So yeah, that in terms of that, that's where it helped me in terms of networking. So yeah, it's the networking is the big thing, and you'll see as you get into working and into careers, networking plays a massive role. So in my field, not necessarily a big impact in the sports field, but in a, as sort of career as a whole, I think networking through the Presence Award is very, very beneficial.
Beneficial, yeah. What memories or fond memories do you have of your time at St. George's? If you had to pick, like, say, two or three, which ones would pop into your head?
So the question
that
is,
you would like to share and you would be willing to share. There's not going to put you in too much of a spotlight.
Not the ones we got reprimanded for. I think one of the fondest memories was going on your class camps every year. I don't think a lot of schools have that call it luxury or privilege to go on a camp almost every year. And we had that. And for me, that was always some of the best times. It was always fun. I don't remember a year where we did not go on a school camp. And you know, people often talk about when you arrive at school and you see the buses outside, you know you're going on a class trip. Those are always because you're missing out on schoolwork. So yeah, for me, the school camps is always the fun times, and that's what you sort of remember the most.
And there's also school camps is sometimes where the friendships and the bonds between each other are deepened and created more strongly. And it sounds like you're still quite in contact with a lot of your fellow classmates and those around your year.
Yeah, it's my battery's low. That's also when you'd see a different side of the teachers as well. So that's also quite a nice experience. With my classmates, a lot of us are spread all over, quite a number in Joburg, Pretoria, quite a few overseas as well. So it's often difficult to meet up and catch up. But luckily, because of social media these days, you can always keep in touch and see what's happening.
And I have one last question, which has more to do with things that you are involved in now. You are with the Justice Desks, a human rights organization. Tell us a bit more about that.
Yeah, so I got involved with the Justice Desk this year, and that was via a friend of mine who was also on the President's Award. She was the chairperson of the youth committee 2 years after I was there, and she always said that she saw me as a mentor. So the Justice Desk is a human rights organization, and they run two programs at the moment, one called Mbokodo, which is the girls program, and another one called Ntsika, which is the boys. So with the Mbokodo girls, they take girls from different communities, mainly Nyanga and at the moment, and Bontebal, and a lot of them are victims of sexual assault or rape survivors. With their program, it's more focused on sort of reclaiming their power, empowering them in different ways, also providing counseling when they are ready for it, creating a safe space for them to find themselves again, which is often a challenge after girls go through that type of experience. And then with the boys in the Ntsika program, it's a lot of the boys do not have father figures. So we as mentors try and be that father figure and try and sort of gear them in the right direction. They're boys that are identified as sort of at-risk youths in a sense. And the object behind the boys program is also to educate them about gender-based violence, to challenge those stereotypes and to change the narrative around what is accepted and what's not accepted. And it's just really trying to create a better...
We seem to have lost Shaun. Well, we'll try and get him back and continue the talk. If you are not able to join us today live, please feel free to visit the Old Georgian website where all the talks will be uploaded. And you'll be able to view them at your own pleasure. And if you would like to get involved with any of the talks and share your insight, please feel free to contact the Old Georgian office, and we will gladly help you out at or put you up on one of our talks there. It looks like we have Shaun back, or he's busy connecting.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. We lost you for a moment there.
Yeah, my laptop charger is at the bottom in the team room, and it's a bit far to fetch it now. I didn't realize how low my battery was. As I was saying, the Intika program is we provide the boys with a lot of different skills, whether it's, you know, leadership, communication, those kind of things. But also we have the educational sessions about, like I said, gender-based violence. How to sort of challenge it. And it's really just raising awareness about it and also changing that mindset so that the boys can go out into their communities and be those ambassadors for the fight for human rights and challenging gender-based violence. So that's what the Justice Desk is about. It's a great organization. I can send you the link for the website, and people can donate if they'd like. They're always looking for support and also always looking for mentors or mentees. And if there are old Georgians out there that would like to get involved, they're more than welcome to contact me for more information. And I can put them in touch with the relative people. And so every sort of second Saturday, we have a session with the kids in Stellenbosch.
Okay. That sounds like a really great initiative, and great to see that another old Georgian's doing something of service to others out there. So well done, and thank you for getting involved there. Shaun, I know you got some rugby things getting planned or involved there. Quickly, I know I said one more question, but I've got one more question. What, you moved into the line of sport and rugby. What did St. George's, or where did you get that? Did St. George's have any influence in you moving in that line? And if so, please share. Or has it always just been something that has been your passion and you pursued it?
Taught
you passion to pursue.
Yeah, exactly that. But it's also funny that the year I joined the school, 98, I think was the last year we had rugby at the school. So I never had the chance to play rugby at the school. I never actually played rugby competitively. And now I've been working in rugby for the past 7 or 8 years. But the passion is really about the sport. I've always loved sport. I've always been into sports. And I enjoyed my time at St. George's, where I played almost every sport the school had to offer at some point in my life. I've played chess, squash, table tennis, badminton, not really badminton, athletics, cricket, soccer. So yeah, I had the chance to experience all types of sports at the school. So that fulfilled my passion for sport. It's just the way I got into rugby was sort of by luck and by chance. But I've been very fortunate in my experiences so far. I'm very grateful for the experiences I've had.
Awesome. So, well, thank you for joining us today, Shaun, and sharing your bit of your story and input. And good luck with your travels back to Cape Town or back to Stellies. And good luck with your next match that's coming up. And I hope that we can have some gatherings again at the school where we can get some of the members of 2009 together again there.
Our next match is tomorrow night at 7 o'clock on SuperSport 2-1-1. Just throwing that out there if you want to join. And then we'll play on Friday again at 2 o'clock. So keep an eye out for Stellenbosch.
Keep an eye there. So good luck with that one there. So thanks again there, Shaun. And tomorrow, the 27th of April, we're celebrating, it's the 27th anniversary of our first democratic non-racial elections. So take a moment to remember all those and appreciate those that fought the fight for that and how far we've come, and be grateful for what we have at present and happy Freedom Day. And we'll see you at our next talk, which will be fairly soon. So thanks again.
Thanks for giving me the opportunity, Stephen. I really appreciate it. All the best outside at the school.
No, thank you. Keep well. Bye-bye.